Raw and confronting is how a report into the Queensland Police's response to domestic violence has been described by the Premier and Commissioner. Let's go live now to today Queensland reporter Mia Glover. Mia, the Commissioner holding on to her job this morning.
Yes, she certainly is. Ali, good morning to you. The Premier says she still backs the current leadership team, and that includes Police Commissioner Katerina Carroll, saying that she's still the one to clean up the service and also implement the some 78 recommendations made in this report. Now, this was very, very hard reading when the report was handed down yesterday. Some of the revelations that came out of it include the failure of leadership within the service, misogyny, sexism, racism, and the big one that affects so many in our community, the failure of victims of domestic and family violence. Some $100 million will now be spent on fixing the system. That will include 24/7 DV response units, which will be placed right throughout the state, and also setting up a police integrity unit so that any complaints about police can be made to that one body. Here's what the Commissioner and the Premier had to say.
I am extraordinarily confident that with the timeframe set around this, the structure in which that we are going to deliver it, the oversight by Linda Appelt, that you will see some extraordinary results immediately.
I cannot think of a more appropriate person to lead the reform than a strong woman.
Ali, the Police Commissioner will be live on the Today Show a little later this morning.
Well, Queensland's Police Commissioner says she won't stand down despite a shock report finding sexism and racism is running rife at the service.
She admits they, quote, should have done better, now promising major cultural changes. Queensland Police Commissioner Katerina Carroll joins us now in Brisbane. Commissioner, thanks for your time this morning. Were you surprised you held on to your job?
Government knows the reform that I have started. They know the track record I have. You know, I spent 4.5 years in another department doing cultural reform in earnest. I have come back from that department in the Queensland Police Service for the last 3 years and doing exactly the same. Reform in cultural training, in DV training, processes, systems, you know, performance frameworks, leadership frameworks, so they know that. So I thank them for sticking with me to continue this reform. It is extraordinarily important. And with the resources and with the recommendations, it will actually expedite the reforms.
But were you surprised you held on to your job, considering how damning this report is?
It is a difficult one. I haven't pondered on it. I know that I have the support from the Premier. I know that I have the support from the Minister. These problems didn't start, you know, the day that I came into the organisation. They have been around for decades and in other like organisations as well. All commissioners come along and try and make, you know, a change, a significant change to make things better.
The problem
and
is that
is my commitment into the future, to work hard to make sure that we improve this situation in what predominantly is a good organisation. And these examples have let victims down internally and externally, and in many ways it's a dark day for our organisation.
It is, look, I've known you for a long time, but this report is incredibly damning, no reflection on what you did before this job. But this particular report, I mean, it even said that you didn't think there was a problem with the culture at the force. The report found you oversaw a culture of fear and silence. You didn't understand the ethical complaint system that was introduced under your watch, and you failed to denounce misogynistic remarks from two senior officers. It's pretty damning of you.
It is very personal, and I and accept that. The system, the discipline system, was actually trialled before I came in, and the discipline system was trialled and found to be effective. However, when we went throughout the years, it wasn't effective. As soon as I found out that it needed to be improved, I definitely did. You look back on the things that you've done and implemented and you say to yourself, could I have done differently or could I have improved it? I think definitely. But when you look at my track record and when you look at what I have done in reform, I have certainly done a lot over many years in the best interests of the community, in the best interests of my people, to make sure that we do have a good reform agenda, not only in the past, but now and into the future.
Look, as the person who then oversees the force, I mean, were you aware that there are officers making jokes about domestic violence, that they were ranking victims on their looks, and that some believe that women often make up allegations about sexual or domestic violence? Were you aware of any of that?
So what happens, that does come to the discipline system, that does get investigated, so each of those complaints do come through the system. So definitely I was aware, they go through various part of a discipline process, and depending on what it is, it gets dealt with within that system. It is appalling behaviour, it is unacceptable, and it is being dealt with.
The judge also warned the failings of the current system were so great, the risk of failing to protect against misconduct were significant. Given what's happened whilst you've been operating as the head of the force, how can we have confidence that you will enact it, that people won't fall through the cracks, that there will be that significant change when it hasn't happened yet?
There definitely will be that significant change. As I said, Carl, you know, I have been leading reform for 3 years in what has been a very, very difficult and complex environment, as you can appreciate, what we've been subjected through at COVID. I would love that reform to have been expedited and at a faster pace. When you look at the recommendations, though, and the resources that come with it, that will definitely be the case. I think reforms will happen very, very quickly. There are very tight timeframes. I've agreed with government that a lead deputy takes over this next stage of reform, who will report to government and work with me in this space. So I'm extraordinarily confident that this will be addressed a lot quicker than it has been in the past.
But just given that,
particularly with the resources.
But just given that, the Premier said there was no one more appropriate to lead the reforms than a strong woman in yourself, but they actually are going to implement the reports, the 78 recommendations, with someone else. Was that a blow to you? Did you see it as that?
Oh, no, definitely not. I actually agreed to that. I think that is a very good way of going about this. There is a lot of reform work currently in the QPS, another couple of pieces of work that will also be picked up. I think that's an excellent way of achieving this. There is a supervisor that's sitting over the top of this as well, Linda Pelt. I think it needs to be done alongside me as a piece of work to really signify the importance of it. I've already spoken to the deputy in great detail about this, and I think this will work nicely into the future.
But I mean, how does a woman on the force feel safe, and how does someone feel safe reporting a DV or sexual assault allegation, considering what exists within the force at the moment?
Ali, I want people to have confidence in the Queensland Police Service. You know, the reporting of domestic violence has exponentially increased. And I go to that point that predominantly people in this organisation, day in, day out, go out to make their communities safe, to protect them, join the organisation for the right reasons, like I did. So please have that confidence. But yes, those examples are horrific. It is a dark day. We have let our community down, our people down, but certainly the reform has commenced and the reform will continue in earnest.
You have shown over the years to have a real toughness about you and a propensity to enforce change. I wish you all the very best in cleaning this up.
Yeah. Misogyny, sexism and racism have been running rife in the Queensland Police Service for years. That's according to a new report which found this culture has inhibited the policing of domestic and family violence.
It was a pretty damning report. We spoke to the Commissioner of Queensland Police, Katarina Carroll, on Today a little earlier. But this particular report, I mean, it even said that you didn't think there was a problem with the culture at the force. The report found you oversaw a culture of fear and silence. You didn't understand the ethical complaint system that was introduced under your watch, and you failed to denounce misogynistic remarks from two senior officers. It's pretty damning of you.
It is very personal, and I accept that. The system, the discipline system, was actually trialled before I came in, and the discipline system was trialled and found to be effective. However, when we went throughout the years, it wasn't effective. As soon as I found out that it needed to be improved, I definitely did.
OK, Sue and Lloyd Clark are the parents of Hannah Clark, who was killed along with her children in a domestic violence incident in 2020, and they join us now from Kingaroy in Queensland. Good morning, you two. Thanks for being with us this morning. How are you with all these findings?
Good morning, Carl and Ellie. The findings are shocking, but I really think Katerina Carroll is the right person to get it sorted out. We actually haven't had any problems with the QPS. They've been treated us very well. They treated Hannah very well in the short time she dealt with them. There were some human errors, I'll admit that, but I think they have tried very hard to try and straighten things out and start to educate the force now.
Well, I think that's actually then something that's important to point out, because in this report they found that there were jokes being made about domestic violence between officers, and there were thoughts that women actually made up some of these allegations. But I think it's important to hear from you that is not something that you personally experienced.
No, we were very lucky. From the first time Hannah walked into a police station, she got a lovely young woman who believed in her and assured her she wasn't making things up. And Hannah came home and felt so validated that someone had listened, and she actually did have a problem.
I guess the issue here is that then for many victims, or those who've reported incidents of domestic violence or coercive control, looking at this report, they've not been believed.
And look, I'm sure that happens. I've spoken to a lot of survivors, and unfortunately it seems to be 50-50. Every second woman does get an uninterested or not an empathetic listener, and they get shunned and sent away. And then the other half, they get a good policeman who listens to them and helps them the whole way.
Well, it's human nature, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know, you only have bad eggs in anywhere, any workforce. So I think, you know, they're starting to weed them out now, and especially with the DV side of it, they actually are sort of listening and implementing stuff that the McMurdo report has said. So, and even at our inquest, you know, co-responders to go out with the police. It's just that they weren't educated enough and they didn't know about coercive control and what was going on. But now we've got the funding, but we still need more, and we still need more police out there in that specialised DV sector.
And this is part of the problem too. I mean, you don't want to run the morale down for the entire force, given how hard it is to recruit people anyway, and how difficult the job is on a day-to-day level dealing with these kind of issues. But to have more of them and to have more education is crucial here. What kind of reform and cultural change would you be hoping for to come from this?
Well, what we've seen so far, there's been some trials where they actually are using co-responders. So it's counsellors who are actually in that DV side. So they're going out with the police, they're talking with the customers, and basically, you know, working out and then coming back and actually talking to the young uniforms and saying, well, this, maybe we'll do it this way, maybe do it that way. And they're now finding that the uniform guys are actually more involved. They're actually, you know, once before they didn't want to go to a DV case, but now they're getting more involved because they've got that confidence now. They know what they're actually doing.
Well, look, I mean, I think you guys have been pivotal in us seeing the change that we're seeing now, and the charity you set up, Small Steps for Hannah, is doing such amazing work. So I guess thank you for helping to bring this to light, and hopefully we see all 78 of those recommendations implemented and things improve. Thank you.
Well, it's all about the education. And we're actually working with Lady Musgrave Trust, and we've got an ad campaign out there called The Red Flags. So, I mean, people just need to get onto that, watch that, and it gives you a bit of an idea on coercive control.
I love catching up with you two. You've been making such a difference. Appreciate your time.
Thanks, Sue. Thanks, Lloyd.